kapatayım.
Prep school.
Great, great. İlker, you'll be the first presenter, but we can wait. Maybe we might have some more people coming.
Sure, hocam.
And your topic is investigating English preparatory school students language learning strategy use and achievement scores. Really good.
Yes, hocam.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's like 5:02, so İlker, maybe we can start with your presentation. We will have five different sessions, so if you can keep your presentation for like 12 minutes, and then if we can have 3 minutes for a discussion and then also some questions, that could be great, okay?
All right, Jim, I will do my best.
Okay, okay. I may not be the host. I see Barış Hoca here. He might be the host. So Barış Hoca, can you please give the privilege to open the share screen function?
I guess I can do it.
Okay, maybe it is by default, it is already set. So, okay, yeah, let's see.
Okay, it says host disabled participant screen
sharing. Yeah. Okay, let me call Barış Hoca. Mm-hmm. He might be online, but he may not be there. Let's see participants here, who is the host? I'm the host. Great, I wasn't aware of it. Okay, good. İlker, you can try it now?
Okay, hocam, now I can
do it. Okay, great. Okay, so thank you very much. Yeah, we can see it, İlker.
All right, hocam.
Really good, thank you very much.
My pleasure, hocam. First of all, good evening, Doğan hocam and dear participants. My name is İlker and I'm doing my master's at Sabancı University. And here, I am here to present the study. Let's continue, let's start with the structure. I will start with a little background information and give the details about the methodological procedures for the present study. After the results and possible reasons behind the findings, I'll end the presentation with some implications and suggestions. So as we all know, by the way, let me take this. Here. As we all know, human mobility and interaction around the world required a bridge language, which has been English for decades. It paved the way for effective language learning. With the trend towards student-centered learning, a number of factors such as motivation, language anxiety have been highlighted by the researchers about language learning. And learning strategies are one of these factors. Researchers have tried to identify and classify these strategies. They also focused on the determinants of strategy use. Okay. So in this study, the researcher aimed to identify the language learning strategies used by EFL learners in a prep school. It also investigated the relationship between strategy use and achievement. As well as the relationship between strategy use and proficiency level and gender. Yes. So the nature of strategies is a bit hard to define. Many scholars defined the strategies from different perspectives. While Stern describes them as general tendencies, Weinstein and Meyer see them as thoughts and actions. On the other hand, Rubin and Oxford provide more details about the possible outcomes of employing strategies such as better storage of new information and easier, faster, or more enjoyable learning. Griffiths pays attention to consciousness as one of the requirements to call an activity as a strategy. It is also necessary to see the difference between these two concepts, style and strategy. Styles refer to habitual patterns of pursuing, processing, or reacting to information, and they can be categorized under three headings, like sensory preferences, cognitive, and personality types. Strategies, on the other hand, are the observable forms of students' underlying learning styles. In other words, the style plays a key role when the learner decides on which strategies to follow. Of course, the numerous attempts to define strategies led to many taxonomies with different focal points. However, Oxford's taxonomy stands out as being more elaborate and comprehensible thanks to its individual strategies based on four basic language skills. Here you see the direct strategies. Memory strategies are about storage and retrieval of new input. Cognitive strategies for the comprehension and usage of language in different forms. Compensation for the maintenance of linguistic performance despite the lack of information. On the other hand, indirect strategies are comprised of metacognitive ones for organizing the learning process, affective ones to take the maximum advantage of feelings and motivations, and social strategies to enrich language learning through interpersonal communication. So based on the research into this area, a number of factors are very likely to affect the strategy choice. Some studies show that the more motivated learners are, the more diverse strategies they use. Chen states that relatively older learners employ more social strategies. Lai and Griffiths say that students with higher proficiency levels employ more strategies with a wider range. Lastly, gender is another factor. Some studies show differences between the male and female in terms of strategy choice and frequency of usage. How about the language learning strategies and success? The majority of the studies establish a significant and positive correlation between these two points. However, there are a few studies that claim the opposite, like Chucker and Murray. So this study employed a mixed method design and it was conducted by almost 350 prep school students. They were studying English at three different levels. And to collect the data, these are the instruments, demographic information form, a strategy inventory that is based on Oxford's taxonomy, students' final grades and some interviews. To analyze the data, the researcher made use of SPSS and thematic analysis. Regarding the first research question, the participants reported using overall language learning strategies with a medium frequency. Metacognitive and social strategies were used most frequently, while affective strategies were used least frequently by the participants. So what does that mean? So the overall strategy used indicates that participants are neither ignorant nor sophisticated about the strategies. It might be because of the lack of explicit instruction on strategies. Metacognitive strategy use shows that participants are good at coordinating their learning process. And it might be because of the course book, by the way, because they complete self-assessment checklists at the end of every week. They have online interactive activities. So these also support self-monitoring. So coursebook and communicative methodology that are based on coursebook and school's mentality, that are based on communicative methodology might be other factors behind the high usage of social strategy use, because a large number of activities such as role plays and debates can be influential in increasing cooperation and collaboration. Regarding the use of affective strategies about the feelings, all the interviewees expressed how excited and nervous they felt while using the target language. But as we all know, as we see here, affective strategy use ranks at the bottom of the list. So it indicates a lack of awareness about how to control feelings. The findings also show that high achievers employed more strategies compared to low achievers. It indicates that high achievers are not only active strategy users, but also successful at orchestrating their strategies effectively. On the other hand, low achievers seem to be unfamiliar with most of the strategies. Thirdly, students with higher proficiency level reported using more strategies and more frequently. It could be because a better command of English may lead to engagement in more diverse materials and situations, and this situation might provide them with more opportunities to employ such strategies. Regarding the last question, the female seemed to employ more strategies than the male. And Green and Oxford, as you see here, state that learning styles, motivations, and attitudes of the female students could be playing a role in the frequent use of language learning strategies. Attitudes towards, especially towards learning a foreign language. So these results imply that teachers can arrange strategy development sessions for language learners, and integrating strategy-oriented sections into language textbooks and teacher education programs could help to raise awareness about the strategies. Finally, future studies could focus on the same points with larger number of participants, especially by collecting qualitative data. Lastly, it will be also beneficial for the field to investigate underlying reasons behind the rare use of certain strategy types and other possible determinants of language achievement. Here are the resources I made use of while preparing this presentation. And I would like to conclude with a proverb, actually by modifying this proverb, by showing our students how to use strategies effectively, we can help them to learn English easily. Yes, and the other languages as well. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, İlker. Is it like your master's thesis?
Yes, hocam, that's true.
Okay, really good. That was a comprehensive study, a nice one.
Thank you, hocam.
Thank you for sharing it with us. Do you have any questions to İlker? Yes, thank you very much, İlker. If after the presentations, if we have some more time, we can talk more about the specific issues. But overall, I do think that your presentation was quite nice and informative. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jan, for your kind words.
Okay, we'll continue with Selin. And then Selin's topic will be about L1 use in a foundation university, I guess. Right?
Not a university, in a foundational secondary school and a public secondary school.
Okay, good. I just saw the first part. I couldn't read it because of Zoom. Thank you very much, Selin. It's your turn right now.
Okay, Hocam. How many minutes do I have?
Again, we will have 15 minutes, but 15. Then if you can talk around 12 minutes, then we might have 3 minutes for a discussion.
Okay, Hocam. Mm-hmm. Most of you know me, but for the ones who don't know, I'm master's degree student in Kocaeli University.
Selin, are you going to use a PowerPoint?
Yes, Hocam. I will share it.
İlker, can you, or maybe I should do it? Okay, yeah. Great. Then, okay, thank you very much, İlker.
I'm a master's student in Kocaeli University, English Language Teaching Department, and also I'm an English teacher in Bitlis. My topic is the differences of L1 use by teachers and students in an English course in foundational school and a public school in Turkey. Talk about the statement of the problem. You know, although the use of L1 has been an essential part of many language classrooms, the debate of using L1 continues among teachers, educators, and researchers. And the question is, while we are stating the problem, should L1 be used in the EFL classroom, and is it acceptable to use L1 in the EFL classroom, and the, what are the advantages and disadvantages of using L1 in the classroom? The significance of this study is it shed light on the differences of teachers and students' frequency of level of L1 use, which would be helpful for EFL teachers and teacher education programs in terms of examining how much when and why teachers and students use the target language and the first language in the classroom, I mean the foreign language classrooms. And the purpose of this study, it aims to show the differences of L1 usage and their reasons behind it. I mean language background, language proficiency, and students' social status. So, you know, it depends on the region, L1 use and region. And let's talk about a little bit literature review. According to Miles Turnbull and Katie Arnett, exposure to target language input, student motivation ways in which teacher use of the first language can promote target language learning at cognitive levels. And students should exposure to the target language. This can maximize the target language learning in the classroom. And there's a direct correlation between foreign language achievement and teacher use of the target language. And, you know, in today's world, teachers started to create an awareness about avoiding L1 use in an EFL classroom. But sometimes it's not a successful thing, I think, because, as I said before, it depends on the region that you teach the course. I mean the language, because here we cannot use target language during our courses, and our students say that go to the director and says our English teacher is speaking English, so that's why we cannot understand anything. So it's not a good thing for us. So we have to use L1 in the classroom. And they think that teachers shouldn't use first language during their lessons in order to maximize target language. Here, the maximize means optimal use of L1 and target language use. And so if teachers want to increase the use of target language, they should use it in the classroom. But as I said, it depends on the students and the classroom environment. And according to Cook, he believes that the use of L1 deserves a place in the target language classroom. And he approves the use of L1 both for teachers and students in the classroom. Here, one lawyer agrees contending that teachers' use of the learners L1 helps to create more salient input for the learner, hence promoting intake. And according to him, the quality of the input is more important than the quantity of the input. When it comes to intake, and introducing the L1 can enhance the quality of the input. Using L1 by the teachers in the classroom can create a more comfortable learning atmosphere for the language learners, because this is a foreign language and they feel foreign themselves. And according to Turnbull, teachers should use target language as much as possible in their teaching, as the others said. Especially in the context in which students spend only short periods of time in class on a daily basis, and when they have little contact with the target language outside of class, so they should use the language. And what are my research questions while doing this study? And the central research questions were like this. What are EFL learners' opinions about the appropriate use of L1 in the classroom? And what are the reasons of EFL teachers and students' use of L1 in the classroom? Are there any similarities and differences of L1 use between public school and foundational school students? And there is a huge gap. Should L1 be used in the EFL classroom, and what are the advantages and disadvantages of using L1 in the EFL classroom? I want to mention about my methodology, and this study involved the observation of classroom talk in two different schools in Turkey. The data of this study came from audio recording with sixth grade students in an English lesson, but in different cities in Turkey. 65 minutes data have been transcribed and analyzed by the researchers. And the analysis of this study revealed the differences of L1 use in EFL context in a foundational and public secondary schools in Düzce and Van. Foundational school was in Düzce and public school was in Van. The participants were sixth grade students and they have different language backgrounds. There were 35 students in public school classroom and there were just 16 students in private school's classroom. And the ages of students are between 11 and 12. And their language proficiency level is A1, but some of them are better than A1, especially in foundational school. And there was a non-native English teacher who is 5 years experienced in Düzce, and there was a non-native English teacher who is only 1 year experienced in Van. And in this study, students' language proficiency levels differ from according to their schools. Although they are at the same grade, their use of target language is not sufficient enough in public school. So they use L1 mostly during their courses because of their deficient language background. Data collection and analysis. The data was gathered through an audio recording with sixth grade students. As I said, the audio took 35 minutes and in public school, it just took 30 minutes. And after the audio recording of the lesson, the researcher listened to the each school's recording twice and labeled the instances of L1 use coming across during the lesson. Then the episodes were transcribed and coded based on the research questions, and researcher analyzed this study in order to compile, understand, and communicate the findings in a more explicit and reader-friendly way. Here are examples from findings in the study. In excerpt one, here you can see a teacher's reaction to L1 use by the student in public school. Here the student say, the teacher is asking what is homework, and the students cannot understand homework. They say sayfa, no homework. They say ödev diyor galiba, and the teacher says yes, I mean ödev. He doesn't say I mean homework. And he also uses L1 in the classroom. In excerpt two, teacher's reaction to L1 use by the student in private school. Students say, Kerem vurma sana bana. The teacher says, come on guys, I don't want to listen to your noise. Ama vuruyor ne yapabilirim? And we can see that students can understand each sentence, but they still use L1. And the teacher ignores and says, okay, look at exercise five and stop talking. Then the learner says, come on, yeah, be quiet, guys. And they understand and use this target language. And here, the use of L1 by the teacher with the purpose of translation in public school. As you can see in the right part, here student says şov göstermek demek, göster dedin değil mi teacher, and teacher says yes, show me please. He still tries to use target language, but especially it depends on the students. And here you can see the purpose of translation in private school, I mean the teacher's reaction. okay, what is the meaning of this word? Which word? Students is asking, and I say colorful. She says colorful, and then teacher says it means there are lots of colors in it. For example, pink, blue, yellow, and the lesson continues in the target language, and they can understand easily. Finally, and the results. The overall findings related to this study show that the instances and samples of data are consistent with the other studies in this field. And it showed us frequency and differences of L1 use in the EFL context in a private and public secondary schools in Düzce and Van. It showed us different language uses in different locations in Turkey. And it suggested that teachers use L1 in the Turkish EFL classes for such kind of reasons as referring to common vocabulary items, grammar instruction, classroom management, social and affective reasons, lack of comprehension, and etc. When the teacher's reaction include ignoring topic continuation in English. Using target language can motivate the students in the classroom because, as you see in excerpt 1 and 3, the students are trying to respond to their teacher in the target language. So teachers should use the target language as much as possible in their teaching, and this increases their fluency in English and maybe their motivation. As I said before, L1 deserves a place in the target language classroom. Here are my references. That's all. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Selin. That was a nice presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Hocam.
And we'll continue with Fatma Aslan. Our topic will be problems experienced by foreign secondary school students based on teachers' views. Yes, Fatma Hocam, it's your turn right now.
Hocam, Türkçe sunum yapacak arkadaşımız.
Tamam, no problem.
Okay. Ben bir kısa açıklama yapayım Sayın Tabii Başkanım, ki. Müsaade ederseniz. Değerli katılımcılar, herkese merhaba, hoş geldiniz. Malumumuz son 8 yıl içerisinde ülkemize 4 milyonun üzerinde mülteci göç yoluyla gelmek durumunda kaldı. Ve özellikle Milli Eğitim Bakanlığımızdaki okullarda, temelde onlarda 1 milyona yakın farklı şehirlerimizde öğrenci var. Bazı şehirlerde Libya'nın Arapça programı kullanılsa da bu çocuklar oryantasyon ve adaptasyon sürecinden sonra özellikle entegrasyon adını verdiğimiz bütünleşme, Türkiye eğitim sisteminde bütünleşme sorunuyla çok ciddi sorunlarla karşı karşıya kaldılar. Fatma hocamız da kendisi 20 yılın üzerinde bir Türkçe öğretmeni. Benim tesis yüksek lisanstan öğrencim ve kendisinin proje çalışması bu. Biz de proje çalışmasını bir bildiri olarak değerlendirmek istedik ve ortaokul öğrencilerinin yaşadıkları sorunlar üzerine öğretmenlerin görüşlerine dayanarak bir çalışma hazırladık. Kendisi çalışmamızı sunacaklar. Ben sonunda sevgili hocam müsaade ederseniz birkaç dakikalık bir değerlendirme yapacağım. Teşekkür ediyorum Fatma hocamıza.
Ben teşekkür ediyorum hocam. Merhabalar, ben Fatma Aslan. Yıldız Teknik Üniversitesi Sosyal Bilimler Enstitüsü Yabancılara Türkçe Öğretimi bölümünde yüksek lisans yapıyorum. Aynı zamanda da bir devlet okulunda öğretmenlik yapmaktayım. Hazırladığımız çalışma öğretmen görüşleri doğrultusunda yabancı uyruklu ortaokul öğrencilerinin yaşadıkları sorunlar. Bu sorunlara yönelik bir çalışma hazırladık. Çalışmanın amacı...
Fatma, sunumu istersen ekrana tam yansıt.
Tamam hocam. Zannediyorum oldu.
Evet oldu.
Çalışmanın amacı yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin okul ortamlarında yaşadıkları sorunları öğretmen gözüyle tespit etmek. Bu amaçla yapılmış bir çalışmadır. En yakından onları gözlemleyen öğretmenler olduğu için. Ve bu araştırmada nitel araştırma desenlerinden temel nitel desen kullanılmıştır. araştırmayı yaparken veri toplama aracı olarak yarı yapılandığımız görüşme formu kullandı. Ve çalışma grubu olarak da İstanbul ili Kadıköy ilçesinde bulunan ortaokullarda görev yapan farklı branşlardaki 15 tane öğretmenle yapıldı bu çalışma. Onlarla bir görüşme yapıldı. Ve öğretmenlerle yapılan bu görüşmede kullandığımız görüşme formunda yer alan sorular şu şekilde hazırladık. Öncelikle öğretmenlere yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin dil farklılığından kaynaklanan sorunları nelerdir diye bir soru sorduk. Ve bu sorunun içerisinde öğretmenlere öğrencilerin dinleme, konuşma, okuma ve yazma becerilerini edinmede ne tür sorunlar yaşadıklarını, ne tür tespitleri olduğunu sorduk. İkinci olarak yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin sosyal ve kültürel farklılıklarından kaynaklanan sorunları nelerdir diye bir soru yönelttik ve bu soruya da yine alt başlıklar ekledik. Bu öğrencilerin sınıf ve okul ortamlarında öğretmenleriyle, öğrencilerle ve okul yönetimiyle ne tür sorunlar yaşadıklarını tespit etmeye çalıştık bu soruyla. Bir diğer soru, yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin aile özelliklerinden kaynaklanan sorunlar nelerdir dedik. Ve buna da iki başlık, alt başlıkla bu soruyu detaylandırmaya çalıştık. Ve bu soru dahilinde öğretmenlere, öğrencilerin ailelerinin eğitim durumlarının onların okuldaki eğitimlerine nasıl etkisi olduğunu sorduk. Ve bir de ailelerin ekonomik durumlarının öğrencilerin eğitime nasıl yansımaları olduğunu öğrenmeye çalıştık bu soruyla. Son olarak öğretmenlere size göre okulunuzda yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin bulunmasının olumlu ve olumsuz yönleri nelerdir diye bir soru yöneltip onların cevaplarını almaya çalıştık. Öğretmenlerle yapılan görüşmede yabancı uyruklu öğrenciler için öğrencilerde şu sorunların yaşandığını tespit ettik. İlk önce dil farklılığından kaynaklanan işte dinleme, konuşma, okuma ve yazma becerilerine yönelik bir takım sorunlar olduğunu tespit ettik. Dil öğretiminde her ne kadar ses, hece temelli okuma yazma metodu uygulanmış olsa da hece ve sözcük oluşumunda anlam bütünlüğü sağlamada bir takım sorunlar yaşandığını gördük. Yine aynı zamanda ana dillerine göre Türkçenin daha farklı okunup daha farklı yazılmasından kaynaklanan sorunlardan dolayı öğrenme süreçlerinin daha uzun ve yavaş ilerlediğini gördük. Bununla beraber yabancı uyruklu öğrencilerin diğer öğrencilerle aynı sınıfta, aynı ortamda eğitim gördükleri için diğer arkadaşlarının işte onları konuşmalarıyla alay etmelerinden, çekinmelerinden kaynaklanan konuşma problemleri yaşadıkları, konuşmak istemedikleri, bu becerilerini geliştirmekte sorunlar yaşadıklarını gördük. Ve yine bununla bağlantılı olarak da kendilerini ifade etmede, anladıklarını anlatmada bir takım sorunlar yaşadıklarını yine tespit ettik. Bir diğer sonuç kültür farklılığından kaynaklanan sorunlarla ilgiliydi. Kültür farklılığından kaynaklanan çok ciddi sorunlar olmasa da bazı öğrencilerin arkadaş edinme ve öğretmenlerine karşı sergiledikleri davranışlarda bir takım sorunlar ortaya çıktığını gördük. Öğretmenler yine bu sorunların temelinde de aslında dil farklılığından kaynaklanan sorunlar olduğunu, çevrelerinde konuşulanları hemen anlayamadıkları için, söylenenlerin ne demek istediğini tam olarak çözemedikleri için çekingen davrandıklarını, bazen içine kapanık olabildiklerini, bazen de hırçın davranabildiklerini söylediler. Mesela arkadaşlarının yaptıkları şakaları dahi bazen ciddiye alıp çok sert tepkiler verebiliyorlar. Çünkü ne demek istediğini tam olarak anlayamadığı için veya arkadaşının veya öğretmenin espri amacıyla yapmış olduğu bir hareketi, bir davranışı çok yanlış yorumlayabiliyorlar. Bu sebeple de öğretmenleri ve arkadaşlarıyla belli bir mesafe koyuyorlar aralarına. Bu da onların okul hayatlarını, öğrenim hayatlarını etkileyen bir diğer sorun olarak karşımıza çıkıyor. Tespit ettiğimiz diğer sorun ailelerin eğitim ve maddi sıkıntılarından kaynaklanan sorunlar olduğu, okula yansıyan veya eğitim hayatlarına yansıyan sorunlar olduğuydu. Burada da bu iki sorunun aslında birbiriyle bağlantılı olduğunu gördük. Şöyle ki eğitim düzeyleri yüksek olan ve maddi problemleri olmayan, ekonomik olarak sıkıntı yaşamayan ailelerin çocuklarının okul ortamlarına daha rahat uyum sağladığı, daha kolay öğrenme ortamlarına adapte oldukları görüldü. Ama bunun tersi olarak eğitim düzeyi düşük ve bir de geçim sıkıntısıyla boğuşan, mücadele eden ailelerin çocuklarının daha kaygılı, daha dalgın oldukları, eğitim ortamlarına daha zor adapte oldukları, bir yerde aslında öğrenime de kapalı olduklarını söyleyebiliriz. Yine bu bulgulardan çıkardığımız sonuçlar, öğrencilerin farklı alanlarda yaşadıkları sorunlar birbiriyle bütündür. Birbirlerini destekleyen sorunlardır. Bağımsız sorunlar değildir hiçbir şekilde. Ve bu öğrencilerin dil beceri düzeyleri mevcut sınıf kazanımlarının gerisinde kalmaktadır. Figüratif dil kullanımı bu öğrencilerde maalesef yetersizdir. Öğrenme düzeylerinin sınır olduğunu yine tespit ettik. Yine aynı zamanda öğrencilerde aidiyet duygusunun gelişmediğini, oryantasyon ve adaptasyon süreçlerini tamamlamış olmasına rağmen bazı durumlarda bazı öğrencilerin eğitim ortamlarına tam olarak entegre olamadıkları sonuçlarına ulaştık. Bu bulgular ve elde ettiğimiz sonuçlar neticesinde öneri olarak da okullardaki uyum sınıflarının yaygınlaştırılıp kapsamları genişletilmelidir. Yine dil kurslarında sıkıştırılmış programlar yerine zamana yayılmış programlar tercih edilmelidir. Dil kurslarından daha eğlenceli metin ve kaynaklar tercih edilmeli. Çocukların ilgisini çekecek daha eğlenceli, oyunlu, resimli kaynaklar tercih edilmeli. Yine dil sorunlarını çözebilen öğrenciler bu süreçten sonra normal sınıflara alınmalıdır. Daha önceden Türkiye'ye yerleşmiş, dil sorununu halletmiş ailelere yardımcı, gözetici veya rehber gibi sıfatlar verilerek sorumluluklar verilebilir. Yabancı öğrencilerle Türkçe öğrenciler arasında planlı bir şekilde akran eşleştirmesi yapılarak uyum sorunları ve akran zorbalığının önüne geçilebilir. Uyum sürecinde öğretmen koçluğu uygulaması getirilerek oryantasyon ve adaptasyon sorunları en aza indirilip eğitim ortamlarına entegre olmaları sağlanmalıdır şeklinde önerilerimiz var. Dinlediğiniz için teşekkür ediyorum. Hayırlı akşamlar.
Fatma, Sayın Başkanım müsaade ederseniz birkaç bir değerlendirme yapmak istiyorum. Çalışmanın tabii çok fazla ama sunumun sınırı sebebiyle bunları kategorik olarak sizlerle paylaşmak durumundayız. Öncelikle dilsel anlamda şöyle bir önemli sorun çıktı öğretmen görüşlerinde. Dil öğretiminin temeli figüratif dil öğretimi aslında. Yani kavramsal metafor öğretimiyle gerçekleşebiliyor. Çünkü dil kavranabilen bir şey aslında. Ki özellikle günümüzde yapılandırmacı dil öğretimi yaklaşımıyla yaptığımız birçok çalışma bize bunu gösteriyor. Ve öğrencilerde maalesef metafor üretme. Yani bu sadece deyim ve atasözleri boyutuyla söylemiyorum. Kavramsal nitelikte metafor üretmede öğretmenlere bunu sorduk. Çünkü çok ciddi sorunlar var. Ve figüratif dile yönelik temelde üretim sağlayamayan bir öğrenci ister istemez anlama becerilerine yeni söz varlığı girdisi sağlayamıyor. Ve bu girdileri de üretici becerilere aktarmakta çok büyük sorun yaşıyor. Bu dilsel önemli bir sorun. Ortaokul düzeyinde normalde hazırlık sınıflarımız var. Milli Eğitim Bakanlığı'nın bir yıl bu öğrenciler hazırlığa tabi tutuluyorlar. Bununla ilgili bir kaynağımız da var ama o kaynak üzerine de yapılmış birçok araştırma var ve maalesef çok sınırlı ve şöyle bir sorun var. Onu buraya yazmadık ama öğrencilerin düzeyleri birbirinden çok farklı. Farklı durumlarda dile maruz kalmışlar. İlkokulu burada okuyanlar var, okumayanlar var, ortaokulu burada doğrudan başlayanlar var. Bu da sosyal anlamda akran zorbalığı diye sosyolojide tanımladığımız önemli bir alan. Bunun üzerine çalışan sosyolog arkadaşlarımız da var. Öğrencilerin arkadaşlarının zorbalıklarına maruz kaldıklarını gösteriyor. Ve bu da ister istemez duygusal anlamda çocuklarda çok ciddi oranda arkadaşlık sıkıntısı, mahcubiyet, utanma, çekinme, kaçınma ve asosyal bir ortama gönderme yapıyor. Bir de bu çalışmada biz şöyle bir şey tespit ettik. Şimdi bakanlık çalışmalarda en önemsediği basamak oryantasyon ve adaptasyon basamağı. Yani çocukları okula alıştıralım ve adaptasyon uyumlarını sağlasınlar. Nasılsa entegrasyon zamanla gelişecektir diye bakıyor. Ama oryantasyon ve adaptasyon sürecinde yaşanan eksiklikler maalesef entegrasyon, yani çocuğun hem okulla hem sosyal toplumla bütünleşme sorununu o kadar öteliyor ki ve doğal olarak...
Sesiniz kapandı hocam, duyabiliyorsanız beni otomatik olarak ses. Tamam.
Yani oryantasyon ve adaptasyon aşamasındaki eksiklikler öğrencilerin entegre olmasında sınıfa, sadece çünkü entegrasyon aracının temeli dil, entegre olmasına çok büyük bir engel koyuyor. Bu da aslında özellikle Suriyeli mültecili çocukların oryantasyon ve adaptasyonu için sadece okul ortamı değil, okul ortamı dışında da yeni şeyler yapılması gerektiği anlamına geliyor. Ben de çok teşekkür ediyorum sevgili arkadaşım. Ve sizlere dinlediğiniz için sevgili hocalar.
Teşekkürler hocam. Değerli katkılarınız için. Fatma hocam, size de teşekkür ediyoruz. Bizim için de farklı bir konuda, en azından çok da fazla dinlemediğimiz bir konuda güzel bir sunum yaptınız. İkinize tebrik ediyorum hocam. Teşekkürler katılımınız için.
Sağ olun başkanım.
Sağ olun. I will continue in English because our next presenter will be Ayşenur Kara.
Yes.
And she will tell us about the relationship between vocabulary size and academic success. And that will be a case study in Turkey. Ayşenur, it's your turn right now. If you have a PowerPoint presentation slide, then you can share it with us.
I do have a PowerPoint presentation here. So, good evening, everyone. I'm Ayşenur, and I'm an MA student in Kocaeli University in the field of English language and teaching. So I'm going to talk about the relationship between vocabulary size and academic success. The procedure goes as follows. First, I'm going to talk about the purpose of the study, and then the literature review, and then research questions. Then data collection tools and analysis will be discussed, and the results discussion. And at the end, there are some references. So the purpose of the study was to investigate if there's a statistically significant relationship between students' vocabulary size levels and their academic success. So to begin with, I'm going to talk about the previous literature. I'm starting with Anderson and Peabody. There are three hypotheses given by these people. The first one is the instrumentalist hypothesis, which claims that vocabulary knowledge directly influences text comprehension. And the aptitude hypothesis claims that a person with large vocabulary knowledge is better at discourse comprehension. And the third one claims that vocabulary test performance is a reflection of cultural competence. So these three support the idea that vocabulary size and language performance are related factors. First of all, Schmidt and Mira conducted an empirical study on this topic, and they suggested that the ability to form native-like associations in the target language depends both general language proficiency and also vocabulary size. But Schmidt also stated that it is very demanding to measure vocabulary knowledge. Yet there are some tools to measure this notion. The most widely used one is vocabulary size test, vocabulary levels test developed by Nation. And Loafer and Nation also validated this test. And the results of this study indicated that the participants' knowledge of academic words gradually increased through the high school and university. This is also why I chose university students in this study. And Guyon and Nation also conducted a study which is very similar to my study. They measured vocabulary size levels of Vietnamese language learners. And it was found out that academically successful learners achieved high scores in the test. Lastly, Klitsch studied on the role of vocabulary knowledge in writing and speaking performances of Turkish EFL learners, which is also similar to my context. The results of this study show that vocabulary knowledge is significantly related to the performance of productive language skills. So as you can see, previous studies supported the idea that vocabulary knowledge and language performance are highly related to each other. That's why I chose two research questions. First, I investigated if there is a significant relationship between English language and literature department students' academic success and vocabulary knowledge. And if there is no significant relationship between these notions, what could be other factors that affect vocabulary knowledge? So there were 20 participants in this study. They were senior year at English Language and Literature Department at a public university, and their ages range between 18 and 23. And they've been getting formal education of English through instruction for at least 10 years. For data collection, I use vocabulary size test developed by Nation and validated by Bagler, and I collected the participants' GPAs, and then I use SPSS for data analysis. So at this point, I'm going to show you the tool that I've used for data collection, if you can see it. I hope you can.
No, we couldn't can't. See it because you have to open it first, and then that's something about Zoom, Ayşenur.
Okay.
Try it now. Probably we will see it.
Yes.
Start share.
Okay. It's here. This is the test I used. Mm-hmm. It consisted of 100 questions, and it started with easy ones, and then it goes harder and harder. And it took nearly 45 minutes for all participants to complete the test. So you can see the test here, and I'm gonna come back to the presentation.
No, we'll see it.
So the results for the first research question, I questioned if there's a relationship between the vocabulary size levels and the performance of students. So I compared the GPAs and vocabulary size test results. And as I stated before, the research, previous research supported that vocabulary and performance are highly correlated. However, in this study, I couldn't find a high correlation between the two factors. In fact, it is rather low. The results indicated rather low degree of correlation. So the person with highest GPA did not score the highest on the test, and vice versa. So the second research question addressed what other factors could enhance vocabulary knowledge. In this study, I had the duration of second language education, but I didn't see any connection between the factors. However, the time spent on vocabulary learning or the effects of native language vocabulary size on the second language vocabulary size could be important aspects for future studies. And as I stated, it was expected to find a statistically significant relationship between the two factors. However, we couldn't find it in this study, in this context. And in contrast to the expectations and previous studies, academic success couldn't be considered as the primary predictor of the performance in this context. So these are the references, chosen references for my study. And thank you for listening. That's all.
Thank you very much, Ayşenur. Do you have any questions for Ayşenur?
No, thank you very much. It was a beneficial presentation. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ayşenur. That was nice.
Thank you.
Maybe you can extend it in some also other programs, or maybe in the prep school. Maybe in a different setting.
Yes.
There might be some differences, but then in your setting, your findings are quite striking. We would expect a correlation, a relationship, but then we couldn't find it.
Yes.
But then still it was a significant study. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, our last presenter of today will be Zülal. And Zülal will talk about a topic on teaching English to young learners.
Yes.
Okay, Zülal, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Good evening. I am Zülal Karakuş. I am an English teacher in Gaziantep.
Also a master's student at Kocaeli University.
Yes, also a master's student at Kocaeli University, sorry. My topic is program evaluation of teaching English to young learners course through the perspective of undergraduate students. My progress in this presentation starts from introduction to references. If a child acquire language after puberty in at his or her later ages, he will have some problems to learn it. Because in second language acquisition environment, if we want to adjust it, we can also see the same things. Although there are some arguments about starting at the early ages in teaching English, it's thought that it's beneficial for students for their pronunciation, for cultural awareness, and their language motivation for the further stage. And in that point, there are some approach techniques and methods for teaching English to young learners course. So in order to evaluate the program, in order to see if the goals and outcomes of the course reached or not, we can use program evaluation, which means building relationship between programs, initial goals and final outcomes. There are some studies about program evaluation in second language classes, for example, in French laboratories, and students' language abilities and classroom observation and teachers testing, training and orientation. If a study, a program evaluation study deal with outcomes, it's a product-oriented approach, such as a Bangalore and Madras communicational teaching project with achievement test, quiz scores, and performance grades and project grades. There are also a program evaluation studies based on opinions, such as Peacock model. Peacock prepared a model for a questionnaire for EFL students in university program, in order to see the student views. And also there are some studies in Turkey, like a Mutlu's study outcomes and views of students. There are also studies in the English language teaching department with students and lecturers, only students. Also, there is a study with primary teachers carried out by Yashi. She finds that the ones who take a teaching English young learners course, the ones who take the course are better than the ones who don't take. Here are my research questions. What are the perceptions of students in terms of implication techniques, methods, and pedagogical content knowledge of teaching English to young learners course? And what are the course strengths, weaknesses for the students? And what kind of suggestion can be given to the course according to results? There are 28 participants in my study, and the age range from 20 to 35, and 8 of them work in different institutions as an English teacher. And I use a questionnaire prepared by Yashi, but questionnaire, the items were listed by Ustosun as a competency items for teaching English to young learners. I'm going to talk about it later. Data on reliability of my questionnaire is 0.926 Cromba Alpha. I computed this via SPSS 1500. I also use Excel 2016 for GPA. These are the findings. The skills for teaching English to young learners. The first one is theoretical and practical knowledge. The second one is knowing the learner. The third one is planning and organizing. The fourth one is managing teaching. And the fifth one is competence in English. These were the competencies for a primary school English teachers. When we have a look at the average percentages of the questionnaire, as we can see, the percentages, agreement percentages of each item is really high. For example, theoretical and practical knowledge has 71.9, knowing the young learner is 67%, planning and organizing 67.15%, managing teaching 70.8%, and competence in English has 62.5%. GPA of the course for these participants is 2.32 out of 4, which equals 71.40 out of 100. Conclusion and discussion. As a general perception, there is a positive perception about the course and teaching English to young learner skills, which is similar to the Uzun's study. And we can say that it is consistent with the GPA average, 2.32 out of 4. This university has Bologna system. So 2.0 is enough to pass the course. So we can say that it's acceptable. The strengths of the course, theoretical and practical knowledge, competence, especially participants think that they are good at especially developing four skills for young learners. And the second one is managing teaching. The participants has highly agreement on using gestures and body language. And the third one is planning and organizing. The participants think that teaching of listening and speaking English for young learners has the highest percentage, which is 85%, and knowing the young learner competence, especially cognitive and physical development of children, the participants have a high agreement on the item, and also competence in English also high. There is only one problem with the course. Weakness of the course is time managers. Worked with primary English teachers. It's mostly because of, in my study, there are undergraduate students, so they don't have enough experience to manage a class maybe. And it can be more real lifetime practices can be suggested for the program so that they can learn the young learners better. These are my references, and thank you for listening. That's all.
Thank you very much, Tülay. That's also another interesting study that focused on teaching English to young learners course. We can ask to the audience if they have any questions to any of our participants, presenters. Okay, then I'd like to thank you all for presenting your studies, your research, and also I'd like to thank the audience for their participation. I guess the conference organizing committee will be sending out the certificates online. So you should receive them soon. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference and other sessions as well. Thank you very much. Wishing you all a nice lockdown and also a nice weekend.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening to you all. Bye-bye.